Atlantis, the unique geology of the Azores. In this episode, I'm going to attempt to explain why the Azores Plateau is such a unique place from a geological context and why this might present a case for a greater than 130 meter sea level rise in the Azores since the last glacial maximum 20,000 years ago. To truly understand the isostatic mechanisms in the region of the Azores Plateau, we have to look at the world as it was 200 million years ago, when the supercontinent Pangaea began to separate. There have been a number of supercontinents in Earth's history, with Pangaea being the most recent. Pangaea is the result of Earth's previous continental units converging into a new supercontinent. Once the convergence had concluded, Pangaea remained more or less unchanged for 70 million years. So what caused Pangaea to break apart? It is thought that the start of the breakup began as magma surfaced at a point of weakness in the supercontinent, creating a rift zone. This point of weakness would later become the Atlantic Ocean as the rift zone continued to grow. There seems to be some debate over exact timescales, but approximately 20 million years ago, something happened at the Azores Triple Junction that caused the Azores hotspot to produce continental-type crust, as opposed to the oceanic-type crust it had produced previously. The production of this continental-type crust continued for 13 million years, ending 7 million years ago. Over the last 7 million years, the continental Azores Plateau has slowly rifted apart as the Azores Triple Junction has continued to diverge. The Azores hotspot isn't the only hotspot or driver of continental drift, so what makes it so special? When looking at the opposite side of the planet, at the Pacific Ocean, the large body of water makes it clear that the continental land masses are at this point in time still heavily biased towards the Atlantic side of the planet. This map, by Massimo Pietrobon, represents Pangaea using the modern-day continental units. Although the Azores Plateau wouldn't have existed during the time of Pangaea, this map shows how central the Azores hotspot is in driving the continents apart. We know that oceanic plate boundaries tend to subduct under continental plate boundaries. Combine this with the fact that the continental land masses are still biased to one side of the planet, and the fact that all three plates of the Triple Junction are divergent, it might be fair to suggest that the Azores hotspot is the primary driver of modern-day continental drift. It's interesting to note how little is really known about the Azores Triple Junction, considering its potential significance in understanding not only local phenomenon, but also continental geology on a global scale. There doesn't seem to be any agreement on the exact location of the Azores hotspot. Some geologists suggest there might even be two hotspots under the plateau. There are even geologists that suggest there are no hotspots under the plateau, and that other geological mechanisms could explain the nature of the divergent Triple Junction. After reading many papers, I'm of the opinion that there is indeed a hotspot under the plateau, which leads on to another reason why the geology of the Azores Plateau can be considered unique. There has been very little movement of the plateau over the hotspot for at least 20 million years since its creation. Normally you would see evidence of a tectonic plate moving slowly over a hotspot, whereas the Azores Plateau seems to have stayed directly over the hotspot, with only a gradual migration of a few hundred kilometers. Again, this links back to my argument that we might consider the Azores hotspot to be the primary driver in modern-day continental drift. Although I believe there were a number of geological mechanisms that may have been at play when the Younger Dryas came to an end 11,600 years ago, likely by some catastrophe, with regards to the Azores Plateau, I'm going to focus on isostasy. We know that average global sea levels have risen by approximately 130 meters since the last glacial maximum, with the last 60 meters taking place since the end of the Younger Dryas. This is almost certainly true on both sides of the Atlantic, but the Azores, along with other mid-ocean islands with steeply sided shorelines, are a little more difficult to characterize. We can see wave cutting that has taken place since the end of the Younger Dryas at intervals, for the most part, that conform to what we see on either side of the Atlantic, perhaps with some extra subsidence. But due to the steep shorelines, shelf drop-offs, and the build-up of sediment, it's difficult to characterize older shorelines by looking for evidence of wave cutting. There is clear evidence of wave cutting hundreds of meters below the accepted 130 meters, but it's difficult to say at what point over the last 7 million years that these platforms were at sea level. Back in episode 1, I briefly mentioned isostasy. This picture nicely represents top-loading isostasy from deglaciation. The melting of continental glaciers over the last 20,000 years has transferred load from the continental landmasses to the world's oceans. Where ice has melted, the mantle rebounds, causing the lithosphere and a crust to elevate. There is also a corresponding subsidence in oceanic crusts as the load is transferred to the oceans. This top-loading mechanism would certainly have contributed to the subsidence of the Azores Plateau, possibly by more than 130 meters due to the geometry of the oceans, but I don't think it's enough to explain the required 2,000 meters for the Azores Plateau to have been above water prior to the end of the Younger Dryas. In the region of the Azores, I believe that bottom-loading isostasy has had a larger effect on sea level rise than top-loading isostasy. The main driver for bottom-loading isostasy below the Azores Plateau would be variations in the mantle plume, specifically the Azores hotspot, which is estimated to have a diameter of 200 kilometers. Increased activity in the mantle plume has two effects. Firstly, there will be some additional uplift due to the relative increase in pressure. Secondly, the crust thickens. As we know that the crust is less dense than the material below, there will be a corresponding uplift on the surface of the plateau. Unfortunately, we don't have the tomographic data to fully understand the modern-day plume geometry of the Azores hotspot, let alone data to characterize variations in the past. This means that I cannot provide an estimate on how past plume variations have affected the rise and fall of the Azores plateau due to pressure changes below. With regards to variation in crustal thickness, however, we do have access to an interesting paper that could help explain large variations in sea level in the region of the Azores Plateau over the last few million years. One of the hypotheses suggested in this paper is that there is episodic hotspot activity, which causes the crust to thicken to 2 or 3 times its normal thickness, up to a maximum value of 16 kilometers. This occurs in intervals of 3 to 5 million years, suggesting this has happened at least once, possibly twice, since the plateau was fully formed 7 million years ago. This doesn't mean the whole of the plateau increased in thickness, more likely just the crust above the 200 kilometer wide hotspot. Remnants of this localized thickening could be seen as some of the modern day islands or seamounts surrounding the plateau. I haven't just randomly placed a picture of some Tic Tacs into this slide. It's an example of a living hinge that many people around the world will be familiar with. The white plastic top of the Tic Tac container is made from a single piece of plastic. The piece of plastic between the top and the lid is so thin, it acts as if it were a hinge. We call this a living hinge. In like manner, the crust is so thin over the Mid-Atlantic Ridge that it may be acting as an enormous living hinge, allowing the hotspot located under the Eurasian plate to also lift the plateau on the side of the North American plate in times of increased magmatic activity. If this episodic hotspot hypothesis is true, given that the Azores Plateau for the most part is now 2,000 meters underwater, this would suggest that the plume is currently in a period of low activity. I have found 2 papers that seem to back up this statement. The first suggests that the plume, if not of a shallow origin, must be waning. The second suggests that the hotspot is a present-day dying plume. Given the activity periods span millions of years, then it's likely that the present-day period of low activity was still in place 11,600 years ago. Perhaps one day in the distant future, activity will increase, slowly lifting the Azores Plateau back out of the sea. The mechanisms at play would suggest that these variations in the height of the Azores Plateau would take place over long periods of time, conforming to the gradualist school of thought. I would definitely agree with this for the upward motion of the plateau during periods of increased activity, but I also think there are 2 potential mechanisms that could have caused rapid cataclysmic subsidence in the region at the end of the Younger Dryas. Firstly, it's looking more and more likely that the Younger Dryas ended with multiple cometary impacts. Could the Earth changes have been so great causing a disruption to the plume below the Azores Plateau? A sudden loss of pressure under the region certainly could have been responsible for rapid subsidence. Secondly, if the plume was already in a period of low activity 11,600 years ago, then the thickened crust would have been slowly melting back into the mantle below. This downward movement may not have been in perfect isostatic equilibrium. The earthquakes and various earth changes that shook the world as the Younger Dryas came to an end may have only just accelerated a regional cataclysm that would have happened regardless, but perhaps many thousands of years into the future. My hunch is that the combination of top and bottom loading isostasy is enough to explain a change in sea level of 2,000 meters or more since the end of the Younger Dryas. It is unlikely in our lifetimes that we will have the necessary information to calculate past uplift from mantle upwellings in the region of the Azores hotspot, but in a later episode, likely quite far into the future at this point, I would like to try and calculate how much a thickened crust may have elevated the Azores plateau. In the meantime, what other evidence do we have for the subsidence in the region? As I already mentioned in episode 1, Randall Carlson presents papers that detail core samples. These core samples suggest that the region of the Mid-Atlantic Ridge could have been between approximately 3,000 and 5,500 meters higher than they are today. It's definitely worth watching the Cosmographia Atlantis series, as well as the rest of the content produced by their channel. There are a number of interesting man-made artifacts in the Azores that predate the Portuguese occupation of the islands. This picture, from the Portuguese American Journal, shows a step pyramid on the western side of Pico Island. It's one of approximately 140. Academics have placed the age of this pyramid somewhere between 1,000 and 6,000 years old. This would have been made many thousands of years after the end of the Younger Dryas, so it would not be an Atlantean construction. What I'm more interested in is the apparent subsidence. We can't compare this to the Leaning Tower of Pisa, where the foundation sunk into the soil below. The foundation layer of the step pyramid still seems to follow the natural terrain, suggesting that the whole island must have subsided by some degree over the last few thousand years. I crudely make the angle of subsidence out to be approximately 9 degrees, but some of this could be due to the camera angle. Also, this is only one dimension of the pyramid subsidence, as it only shows one side in the photograph. This pyramid, and the other 140 or so pyramids, would be a good excuse to take a trip out to the Azores to try and determine if there is some mutual subsidence that has taken place on the other pyramids of this region. I think this is probably a good place to stop with episode 4. I've had some good discussions with various people on the Graham Hancock message board since I started to make this Atlantis series. I've had some interesting discussions with Open Mind, and Mike D seems to be a wealth of knowledge, providing some good links to various papers regarding the Azores. In the next episode, I would like to present some information from the Temple of Horus at Edfu regarding the Island of the Egg story, as this draws close parallels to Plato's Atlantis story. I know other people have presented similar videos, but I will be linking this into other stories told around the world that may link back to Atlantis. I was also approached by Keith Hunter, the author of Occult Physics, on the Graham Hancock message board. He's found some interesting relationships regarding the placement of my proposed site for Atlantis and other ancient sites such as the Great Pyramid.